Hi, I'm Aliza Ben-Shalom, your marriage-minded mentor, and you're listening to The Dating Coaches Inn. Are you struggling to find quality dates? Have you wondered if your beshert exists? Do you wish you had someone to guide you through the process? Over the last decade, I've helped hundreds of singles from around the world find their soulmate, and I want you to be the next person I help. Picture me as your personal dating coach, sitting on the couch across from you, both of us savoring a cup of tea or coffee as we explore what's working for you, what's not working for you, and what to do next. Each week, we'll discuss different aspects of dating, and you'll receive the insights and the tools that you need to successfully develop a healthy relationship and get over your hurdles and under the chuppah. Make sure to subscribe to this show, and if you like what you hear, please leave us a good review. Thanks for joining me. And now let's get to this week's chat.
I am so excited to be here today. We are with Rabbi Schaefer from The Schmooze, and he has just released his newest book called The 10 Really Dumb Mistakes That Very Smart Couples Make. And I feel really honored and privileged because I got a preview copy to take a look at it and peruse through it. And I found it to be tremendous. When I say tremendous, I don't really give that out. I don't give out compliments lightly, and I don't normally find things so inspiring and with so much depth and wisdom. And I was so excited. I said, listen, I really want to have you on our podcast. I would really love to talk to you, and I really want you to share some of the wisdom that you have for the listeners in our audience, because I think that I know you speak to married couples and especially this type of a book, but for sure, if somebody is dating and they're looking for somebody, then this information is going to be extremely valuable to them. So I'm really excited to have you on and for you to share some of the wisdom, or maybe even like the top thing, the number one thing that you see come up with couples in dating and in marriage, and how we could really help them.
Right. Okay, first of all, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. Okay, so there's one observation that I have that I find on a regular basis. A young man, a young woman are going out and things are good. Things are good, but there's no fireworks. It's like everything kind of matches up. Everything sort of, there's a comfort level and it really, things are working out. And on paper, they're certainly matched up and they enjoy each other's companies and they're going out for a long time, but there isn't that sort of spark. And it's either he or she who says, how can we know? How can we be certain? So let me share with you two observations that I think are very important. Number one, the couples that get me scared, the only couples that get me scared are the ones who are infatuated. It's the one who have the starry-eyed look in their eyes, that kind of glazed sense. And I'll share with you why. Scientists have now studied the brain chemistry to a very real extent, and the serotonin, the dopamine, the adrenaline levels. When a couple is infatuated, there's a real effect on the neurotransmitters equivalent to cocaine use. And what that means is when the couple are high, he's perfect, she's perfect, life is going to be beautiful. Now, the problem there is that your shura sasechel, your intellect, your discerning intelligence is shut off. You're blinded. And those are the couples that get me nervous, because those are the couples that wake up 6 months after or a year after and say, oh my goodness, who is this person? I never met them before. And the reason why they come to that moment is because the infatuation wore off. And that's when it's time to really work on the marriage. And suddenly they're in for rude shock. So the first thing I'd want to share with anyone who's going out is that if you think you need infatuation to know for certain, infatuation is probably the worst sign, because it feels comfortable, it feels good, but it doesn't mean anything in terms of this being the right person.
Right. And I think also when we're talking about infatuation, I think we're talking about fireworks. I really feel connected. I like them. Wow. Oh my gosh. I haven't felt like this in so long. What a pleasure. I don't have to talk myself into this relationship. There's just, oh my gosh, it's exciting. There's something that's just there. And it makes people feel really good in a relationship. But I am in 100% agreement with you. I say when I see fireworks, I know that it's going to go like this. It's going to be a sparkle. It's going to be a glitter. And then we're going to go south for the rest of the road. And and usually it breaks up. And if it doesn't break up, like you said, you get to the marriage point, and then 6 months later, you have this aha moment of, oh my gosh, what did I do? I thought I really cared for them, but there's not enough depth and enough of a real connection there.
Right, right. But there's one more element to it that's actually even, that's, I think maybe it's important to focus on. And that is, a lot of times a couple will say, and particularly, you know, they're going out, things are going real well, but they'll say, wait a minute, if I don't feel that infatuation now, how am I going to love this person? Am I going to be in a loveless marriage? Does that mean I'm doomed to just be flat, you know, for the rest of my life? And this, I believe, is a fundamental error, because infatuation and love in the marriage are only loosely related. You see, infatuation is a mix of sort of mania, sort of newness, a little bit of, excuse my saying, lust. And it's something that's a temporary sort of thing, but it doesn't necessarily correlate in any real way to love in the marriage. Love in the marriage is something that's built, that's worked on, that's real. But you see, infatuation is instant. Infatuation, he looked in my eyes and I was gone. The violins were playing and I was dancing on the rooftop. That sort of sense is instant, but that sort of sense leaves very quickly. Love in a marriage is built. Love in a marriage is worked on. Love in a marriage is something that takes a lot of time and a lot of giving. There are many tools in the book, The 10 Really Dumb Mistakes. I go through many of the tools that bond. When a couple use that, the tools that bond, they become connected. They become really in love. But that's a deep, real love. And if you want to know the key distinction between infatuation and real love, one of the key observations is when you ask a woman who's infatuated to describe the chosen, he's perfect. He's perfect. Everything he does is perfect. When you ask a woman in love to describe her husband, he's a great guy. I love him. Is he perfect? No, he has flaws. You see, infatuation will tell you the person's perfect. Real love is, I see the imperfections. I love them despite that. Because infatuation blinds. Real love attaches. And it's a very different state. So a lot of times, again, a young man or young woman will say, How could I step forward? How could I propose when I won't be in love with this person? The answer is, again, love is something that requires time. It requires building. It's connecting. Hashem gave us many tools that bond. Infatuation is not necessarily an indicator one way or the other whether you'll have a great marriage, a mediocre marriage, or whatever.
Right. Right. So if we can't count on that feeling, that infatuation that gets us over the hump, because I think for some people, without that feeling, they're like, I'm not going to do it, right? If I don't feel it, Rabbi, there's no way I can. How am I going to commit to them? I have a good person. A lot of the times people tell me, I have a good person, and I ask, but are they a good person for you? Do they help you to become a better person? Do they elevate you? Do they bring you up? But how do I convince myself? How does somebody say, well, I like them, I care about them, I feel connected to them, but I don't know if I'm feeling what I should be feeling or what I need to be feeling to take it to the next level?
Excellent question. So I hate to say it this way, but there's another book I wrote called Finding and Keeping Your Soulmate. And in that book, I describe that there are two parts to knowing that this is the right person. The first part is the paper test, and the second is the Bashar test. The paper test is, you see on paper, are you aligned in big picture issues? Are you looking to raise a family the same way? You're looking to build the same kind of house? Yeah, basically, in broad brushstrokes, are you aligned in life goals and what you're looking for in life? But that information is not found out on the date. That information is best found out before the date, either by a shantran or through other means, but it's usually something you don't need to go on a date to find out. You find out in general terms, are you guys holding in the same place? The purpose of the dates are to take the Bashar test. The Bashar test is very simple. It's looking for a certain comfort level, a certain sort of the conversation flow. I enjoy his company. I look forward to the dates. My Rebbe, the Reshiva Zatzal, Rebbe Leibowitz, used to always ask this question. Do you look forward to the dates? Would you rather be with her or be rather in the Beis Medrash, or rather be with her or rather playing basketball? Meaning, if you've been with a person for a long time, and I've had this on a regular basis, I'll ask a young woman, she'll be going out for many, many times, and each date could be 8 hours long, and she'll say, I don't know if we're really connected. I say to her, madam, have you ever spoken to one individual for 8 hours, 10 weeks in a row, and still look forward to being with them, still want to be? So she'll say, I have a best friend. We speak for an hour or two. Yeah, but it's not the same. When you are spending a considerable amount of time together with this person, and there's a comfort level, it just feels right. It just feels natural. That's the Bashar test. The Bashar test is you're looking for one thing, the one that Hashem has chosen for me. Hashem created me, Hashem runs the world, and Hashem decided before I was born who's the right one for me. When I'm going out, I'm looking to see if this is the right one. How do I know? It's just a certain comfort level. It's just a certain, I don't know. It's certainly not fireworks on the 4th of July. It's not infatuation. It's just, I feel right. I look forward. I enjoy his company. It just feels right.
I think that that's great advice. I think some people struggle with anxiety or something behind the scenes that doesn't always allow them to feel that anything feels right. And so when something is masking, I also tell people, well, if you're not looking forward to it, right, is that anxiety speaking or is that you speaking, right? Is there something right. that's standing in that way? So I think there's an important distinction between just feeling comfortable, because I've had many singles who come feeling very stressed out about mm-hmm. the process or even about the timeline. Like they expect an answer really soon. Rabbi, how am I going to tell them in 2 more dates, right? if this is my person and I need 10 more dates. And so I'm always on the side of the single who needs more time. I tell people you can only move as fast as the slowest person in the relationship. And if you're the slowest person, then we have to ask them to mm-hmm. slow down and to give you more time so that Beshert test, so that being in person, I could see over and over again, wow, I'm still going out with them again, another time. And we still talk and it's still comfortable. Mm-hmm. And I guess even if I'm not looking forward to seeing them, maybe that's my anxiety about having to make a decision, but wow, I could spend so much time with them. I could be in their presence. We get along. That's another one of the things that I work on, is just about naturally getting along as opposed to those couples that really have those disagreements.
Right. You know, and just something along that line, I found another issue that comes up often is that, let me share with you an example. A young man asked me the following. I'm going out many times and I just can't be certain. I asked him, do you enjoy your company? Yes. Do you enjoy being with it? Yes. Do you look forward to the dates? Yes. So I said, what's the problem? The problem is, I don't know. Anyway, after a good long time, I said to him, you know something? Here's the problem. I can't tell. I can't tell whether you really enjoy your company, you really want to be with her, and it's the right one, or maybe it's not. I can't tell. What we need is Eliyahu HaNavi. If Eliyahu HaNavi were here, he would tell us whether she's the one right one or not. And listen to the words he said to me. Eliyahu HaNavi would say she's the right one, but that's a problem. I don't want her. And I said, oh my goodness, do you hear what you're saying? He had a certain understanding of what he needed. I need someone X, and she did not meet those criteria. And even though he knew that she was the right one, it felt right, but it didn't meet his, what I call his, you know, his Mr. Potato Head. You know, we all have, you know, the doll, the Mr. Potato Head. You get to choose the eyes, the nose.
Yeah.
Everyone makes their Mr. Potato Head. I know what I need. I need these kind of eyes, this kind of legs, this kind of nose. You know, I make my Mr. Potato Head. Then I go out in the marketplace to find the one that comes closest to the one I'm looking for. That's not looking for your Beshert. Looking for your Beshert is looking for the one that Hashem chose for me. I don't know what he looks like. I don't know what his personality is like. I don't know his intelligent level, and I don't know who he is. I'm looking to see if there's just a sort of natural sort of connection. It just sort of works. And many, many people create their Mr. Potato Head. They go out in the marketplace. They find him. He doesn't match because I know exactly what I need, and this is not it. And they drop their Beshert. And I'm sorry to tell you, you can pass by your Beshert. You could pass by your Beshert. Hashem does not shackle anyone to a particular decree. There's a thing called Bechira. There's free will. And if you decide, I know what I need, and you're not going to play the game the way Hashem wants, but I'm in charge here, you could pass up your Beshert. So I think, again, another issue that often comes out is that a person intuitively has it sense that it's right. They intuitively know it feels right, but I need something else. I need someone extroverted, introverted, with a sense of humor, not sense of humor. I need this level of intelligence. I need this, whatever it may be. And they end up messing up with the system. You have to go out with the understanding Hashem knows what he's doing. I'm looking for the one that Hashem chose for me, not the one that I choose for me.
Yeah, it's so difficult. And it's so difficult when, even if I accept that, right, as a single, I hear what you say and I say, okay, I'm on board with that. I accept this. How do I get myself to behave appropriately moving forward in the relationship, right? Like, I had somebody tell me once, they said, I don't want them to be the one. So I'm not going to continue to go out with them, because if I do, I actually know that I will be convinced that they will be the one. But I didn't like what I first saw, even though I like what I see now. So, and therefore I don't want that they should be the one. Yeah, and I was like, no, don't mess it up. Please don't, please see what you see and realize what you first see isn't always accurate. And what you see later on might be a more true reflection of the person that you're with.
And even more than that, how does a person know what he needs? I'll ask a single following question. Do you know where you're going to be 20 years from now? Do you know what your personality is going to be like? Do you know what interests you're going to have? Do you know what person you're going to develop into? When you get married, Mitzvah Hashem, you're getting married for life. Life means for 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 50. How are you going to make a decision? I know what I need. I know my personality. I know the gender divide. I know exactly where I'll be 20 years, 30 years, 40 years from now. And so I know that this is exactly the person I need. If you had the wisdom of Shlomo HaMelech and you were able to really discern yourself and others, we could debate whether you could make such a choice. But if you think about it, the odds of your correctly calling that shot just aren't. And a person's a lot better off leaving some jobs up to Hashem, because Hashem is quite good at doing what he does. And unfortunately, we human beings are nowhere near as capable. So, I say, again, some jobs are just better off left to Hashem.
So it sounds like we need to not hyper-focus on infatuation. If there are, fireworks, butterflies, all of those things for you and me, we both think that that's a red flag, not a green flag. And it should be something that should be evaluated very carefully. I often tell people, date much longer. If those things are there at the beginning, date twice as long as you would normally date, so that they start to disappear and you could see how you really feel about somebody. It sounds like we need to make sure that we are clear that what we want is something that's going to be good for us, but somehow, right, without knowing what the future holds, we have to align ourselves today and align our values, and then build this relationship. And like you said, with your book, there's all of these mistakes that we make as really smart people and really smart couples, but we'll do that together with our partner, and we'll figure it out. And together, as long as we know that we have not just a good person, but somebody that's good for us, then we can build this long lasting relationship.
Right. I would like to add one last point. I had a fellow who called me up. He's engaged, and he says, Rebbe, how do I know she's the right one? So we spoke. Do you enjoy a company? Do you enjoy? Is it good? Okay. Convince him. 2 weeks later, Rebbe, how do I know she's the right one? We go through the same routine. Do you enjoy a company? Do you look forward to being with her? Is it just absolutely everything perfect? Okay. He calls me again and again from his wedding, an hour before the wedding. He called me. Maybe she's not my Bashert. I told him, I have a little secret to tell you. Would you like to know how you know factually, with veracity, that she's your Bashert? When you walk with her down the chuppah of your grandchildren's wedding, you'll know factually that she was the right one. Until then, you can't know factually. There's some things you have to take that leap of faith. You have to know that Hashem brought you to this place. You have to know there are certain decisions you can't possibly be equipped to make. You can't know the future. You can't know what you're going to need 30 years, 40 years from now. You have to do your best. Your best is you take the paper test. Are you guys aligned in your values? Are you looking to lead a life similar to each other? Are you basically holding in the same place? And then you take the Bashar test. The Bashar test is, you see, is there a commonality? Do the conversations flow? Do you enjoy each other's company? Once you take those two, that's when you close your eyes and you take that leap of faith. You say, I didn't create the world. I don't run the world. I can't possibly know that this is the right one, because I can't make a decision for 40 years, 50 years into the future. I've done my due diligence. I've opened my eyes. I've studied carefully. I've done my best. Now, Hashem, it's your world. I trust in you. You close your eyes. You take that leap forward, and you know that you're doing your part, and Hashem does the rest. I think ultimately that's the only intelligent, sane way that a person can proceed here, because, again, to know factually is beyond our capacity. The only thing we can do is our ishtadlus, and that is to keep your eyes open, pay attention, and see, does it seem to be right? And if it is, you move forward.
Amazing. Thank you so much for coming on, for sharing, for opening everything up to our listeners so that they can have a little more wisdom about how to go about this process. If somebody wants to find you, tell me where the best way is to find you, how they can listen to more lectures, how they can buy your book.
So theshmooze.com, T-H-E, shmuz.com, on the shmuz.com. You could pick up the book. You could, there's a podcast. There's a Shmuz app. There's a podcast. As long as you remember that the Shmuz is spelled funny, T-H-E-S-H-M-U-Z, kind of like Heinz ketchup. If you remember it's spelled funny, you can always find it. And all the information is there.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Okay. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for joining me on today's chat on The Dating Coach Is In. Head over right now to marriagemindedmentor.com/freecall to schedule your complimentary 15-minute intro call with one of our coaches. We would love to speak with you, help you get the guidance and support that you deserve so you can get through the dating process a little bit more gracefully. You'll also find more free content, live webinars, events, everything on our website. And don't forget to grab a copy of Virtual Dating on Amazon. If you like this show, please share it with your friends and make sure to subscribe. May you find someone wonderful this year and share the good news with us.